So thank you very much. I'm here again. This talk, I'm expecting to have a very short talk. It's about the reliability of the product and the robustness. Starting as a point that in the pharmaceutical industry, there are a lot of variability. Variability comes from many sources. For example, variability in the raw material, variability in the processing, variability in the testing parameters. So there are a lot of variability. Now, finally, we can have variability, but we need at least finally to have our product within the specification. So there's no problem, and we have to admit that there are some kind of variability, but the variability should be controlled within certain specifications, and this is basically what I'm going to talk now. So I will talk about the process. It's quite difficult to be here, so okay, I will try. The process robustness, how we are aiming into a flawless production, a process robustness framework, and the principles of process robustness. This is the quality, how it has been perceived from three different disciplines. One of them, how it has been perceived from the product itself, the product quality, how it can be seen from the patient, and the product quality, how it can be seen from the process itself. So if we go and look at the perceived quality from the product part, in the product part, for example, the performance, we are concerned with the therapeutic action, minimal adverse effects, and the minimal interaction, and what will be the source of quality. We will go to the research and development, into the preclinical and the clinical studies, in the chemical formula itself. And this comes from the product itself and the quality. If we go to the, for example, the secondary features of the product, convenient form, lack of adulteration, we will see that in the formula development, clinical trials, pharmacoeconomic studies, it can be seen. Durability, for example, from the product, we have the adequate packaging and the development standardization of materials. They are a source of how to handle, how to control the quality. If we go to the, looking to the product from the eye of the patient, or sometimes from the prescriber, the physician, we'll find the quality as can be seen. For example, I will take this one because it has been addressed during the discussion, that drug originality. And drug originality, it comes from the drug origin certificate, and also the vision from the patient concerning how the effect of the originator with no adverse effect. And this comes also from the institutional issues. Third one, the history of the laboratory, which is the image of the multinationals or the image of the originators. And this is also supported from the marketing point of view. Quickly looking at the quality seen from the process, for example, we say that there are only declared drugs or released drugs to the market are available. In this case, we have to rely on the GMP, GLP, and other quality principles in order to evaluate the product. If we look at the eligible batches to be released to the market, we have to go and evaluate the quality assurance system. So quality is perceived from different points of views, and each one has its own evaluation and looking. Now, what is the process robustness? Process robustness is to demonstrate acceptable quality and performance while tolerating variability. Variability exists, but we need to tolerate such a variability by setting limits, and those limits should be acceptable limits for us. If we want to know what's the meaning of flawless, flawless means that we are having zero defects. We are having zero errors. And in this case, for example, of course, zero lives lost for the product, zero incidents, zero recalls, which is coming because Now it's quite difficult, and zero defects, so also it's difficult. All our aim, any kind of product of good quality, should aim to the 4 points presented here. But is it, let's say, is it practical, or is it possible to have that? Still till now, there are limitations in this part. Why there are limitations? Limitations comes from different reasons. One of them, for example, the percentage. Every year, there are, in 10 years, there has been an increase in the production by 6%, 6% on the world level. So it's a huge number or huge percentage increase. Complexity of the production, number of SKUs, which are stock keeping units, is increasing because each market has its own requirement, each regulatory authority has its own requirement. So number of SKUs for the same product, for the same manufacturer, has been increased. Increasing the number means increasing the possibility and incidence of errors. Also, if we look at the fragmentation of the market, there are more than one source. Industry players are more, supply chain is becoming more complicated, and so there will be a possibility of having more incidents. New product introduction, of course, now they are talking about new technologies. Recently, FDA approved a tablet that has a small chip that gives an indication to the patient that the tablet has finished or the dose he has dropped and you need to take another dose. So such a complication means that there are a bigger possibility for incidents. And of course, one of the most important is the lack of sharing. Lack of sharing, the difference between the pharmaceutical industry and the other industries that we don't share information. In the pharmaceutical industry, information are not being shared at all. All manufacturers, once they are having a problem, they are dealing with this problem with the regulatory authority, and they are trying the best way not to exclude, not to allow the information to go out of their company, because simply it will affect their market share, they might affect their image, they might affect too many issues, so they are trying not to discuss problems with others. So it's the same problem, repetition of the problem with more than one manufacturer, but actually there is no common discussion. For example, compared to the nuclear industry or compared to the semiconductor industry or even the car industry, all of the people, they know what are the defects, and all of them they are taking and they are solving the problem. For example, I don't want to go outside of the scope. For example, Toyota problem with the floor mat, it has been solved not just with Toyota, it has been solved with all other manufacturers. So this is different from the pharma industry. Finally, there are a lot of incidents, improvement in technology, a lot of quality systems are being introduced, but still there are a lot of incidents. Another part, which is what are the reasons that make the pharma industry to lag behind in the implementation of better quality systems. For example, one of them is that the investment or the development or the adoption of new technologies, new quality systems, means that there will be like a stress on the financial aspect. Financial aspect will not be supported by the rewarding, let's say, prices. It's on the reverse side. There you have to spend more and there is a cost pressure on the pharma. Second one, the pharma industry, they try to be compliant. They try to be compliant with the authority without digging deep and looking how they can improve their system. So compliance with the authorities for them is kind of, once they are have incident, they make the CAB analysis, correct action, preventive action program. Most of the times, the CAB results in that they need to train more to revise the SOPs and to do some, I will call it aesthetic effects. And finally, they don't go and look or seek for the problem itself. For example, the process design. Now, process design, it's designed the fastest way in order to have the dossier ready for submission is the good way. They won't go and implement new technologies in order to have a better quality of the product. Because finally, if they do that, the others will be ahead of them and they will be able to register the product, especially when we are talking about generics. So in this case, the aim is to speed to the market, not to the quality aim. Another issue is the governmental incentives to reformulate. So if we say that we need to adopt a new technology, then we have to reprocess all the steps and we have to go and submit to the authority. Resubmission means that you will go to the process from the beginning. Means a lot of fees, studies, reports, follow up with the regulatory. All of this doesn't support the idea of improving the process. Also, the real one here is that digging for more, they fear that if we look more, then some problems will arise. Problems once arise means we need to solve them and we need to convince the authority for that. So it's better not to dig and not to find anything or not to work on developing the process. So briefly talking about the robustness, process robustness, of course this is the Boston College Group process robustness framework. And in this framework, the idea starts by the knowledge creation and the management. Knowledge creation and the management by studying the product life cycle. Studying the product life cycle can lead to information. In the information, we will have too many parameters to be studied. And as Dr. Baird said, too many parameters to be studied is quite a lot of experimental data. In order to solve that, they will approach this, take the risk-based approach. In the risk-based approach, then they can select what are the real affecting parameters affecting the process. So once they can decide the parameters that are needed to be studied, then they will have the two levers, which I will detail in the next slide, the technology lever and the business lever, in which they can build overall the business performance impact, and they will have the process robustness. So what are the levers, the business and the technology levers I'm talking about? It depends on the product life cycle, as I said. So they will start evaluating the product life cycle from the beginning till the end. And in the product life cycle, starting with the process development and characterization. In this part, in the technology levers, we'll find the quality by design approach, as explained by Dr. Byrne, and the modeling and simulation approach. In the business levers, we'll talk about business model redesigning, R&D, process development, manufacturing, and other related issues to the business. If we go to the technology transfer and scale up, we'll find the standardized platforms, modular systems, and we'll find some in the business. We'll find also the parts related, starting with the operational excellence. And finally, the process monitoring and improvement, the process analytical technology, real-time release. Also, from the business part, the operational excellence and the continuous improvement program. All of this, they can build the process robustness. So what are the key principal points in the process robustness? We have that the improvement should be rewarding toward the greatest benefit for the company. Rewarding means that we cannot neglect the impact and revenue part. So revenues are very important in order to establish a good process robustness. And life cycle approach, which need to have a combination between what we are producing, the life cycle of the product, and the outcome that we need to have a robust process in order to have a continuous program and producing the batches every time the same. And the third one is the technology and business levers that should be in synchronization. So it's not the technology part while neglecting the business part. The business part is supporting the technology issues. Briefly, the principles of process robustness, actually, they were explained by Dr. Byrne, like critical quality attributes of the products. And from the critical quality attributes of the products or the parameters affecting the quality, those attributes, we need to decide what kind of parameters that we need to go within the limits of those parameters. Then we have to define the normal operating range of those and also the acceptable, normal acceptable range, then we can control the variability of the process, and finally we can get a robust process. So if we go the critical quality attributes, for example, talking about attributes affecting product purity, potency, stability, critical process parameters, also that are parameters related to those attributes, and normal operating range, and also the proven acceptable range. So we are limiting the variability in a very limited range in which we shouldn't overcome or shouldn't exceed. And the setting the tolerance limits for each process. So now we know in each and every step what are the limits that shouldn't be exceeded in order to finally have a robust process. In the development of the process, we'll find that we need to form a team to define the process that need to do the experimental setup and to analyze the measurement capabilities, identify the functional relationship between the parameters, and then to confirm the critical quality parameters and process parameters to be taken into consideration. So this is basically a very quick approach toward how we can have the robustness of the process. Basically, we can go, if you go to the quality guideline Q10, if you go to the PAT initiative from the FDA, you will find how they are guiding the industry toward to have process robustness that should be clear and the outcome should be well defined. So thank you very much, and I'm ready for questions if there are. Thank you.